So the men's breakfast is coming up this morning. Not this morning, it's coming up at the end of the month, sorry, the 29th of July. So men, please make sure that you make your booking. Invite your friends along. I know the guys in our soul group have been busy planning the men's breakfast. So please be make sure that you invite your friends to come along. And again, a very, very, very warm welcome here at Bethany Christian Church. So just quickly, I also know July is a very busy month in our church. There are a lot of birthdays. I know Auntie Linda has just celebrated her birthday, and then a really wonderful blessing that came along. Her two grandsons were born on Friday as well, so please congratulate them when you see them. Carmen and Lester have been waiting for a very long time, and that's just the faithfulness of God, the goodness of God that came through these two miracle babies that Carmen and Lester have been blessed with and that we get to be a part of. So please wish them, congratulate them, yes. And then I just want to quickly share something with you. Over the last while, this was a challenging season for me personally. And as I ministered previously, I spoke about being intentional. And that's the journey that I'm still on. And during this season, I realized that God was telling me that I mustn't just be intentional, but I have to position myself. So basically what God was saying to me is that you have to let go and you have to position yourself for whatever it is that you are trusting God. And in 2 Chronicles 20, 17, he says, "You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions, stand firm, and see the deliverance the Lord will give you." So whatever you trust in God for, take up the position. Put down what you're busy with. All you can do is what you need to do. So this morning, let's join our worship team. And again, enjoy the morning of worship here with us at Bethany Christian Church.
Pastor William is not here. So for ogen gaan die ding ruk. So I'm sure he's watching online. This morning we have two new songs that I just want to teach you guys quickly so that it's not entirely new when we sing it. The first one is called Fall Away, and the second one is called You've Already Won. God wants us to be like Him. He wants us to be more like Him. Like, He wants us to think His thoughts after Him, and He wants us to do what He has done. And for that to happen, there's a lot of us that needs to fall away. Like, there's a lot of you that you need to put down. Like the Apostle Paul says, you know, you have to die unto yourself every single day. And some people die more than once a day. Me, I die thrice a day. So the first one is called Fall Away. And the chorus goes like this. So come and fill this room, everything apart from you. Let it fall away, let it fall away. It's not what you wanna do, anything apart from you. Let it fall away, let it fall away. That's fairly easy, right? That's not a difficult chorus. Let's do that again. So come and fill this room, anything apart from you. Let it fall away, let it fall away. It's not what you want. called You've Already Won. It's a bit higher. So, your morning voices are going to go for a jog now. A sprint. Bit of a sprint. I'm fighting a
thank you.
certain things in life that you just have to be grateful for, like the birth of a newborn. You know, that's something miraculous. You know, being able to be a father or a mother of children, that's a gift, undeserved. Having God coming down, you know, to die for us on the cross, that's something that we don't deserve. That's something that we didn't ask for, but that we needed so much. And in my life, there are things that I didn't work for, things that were just given to me, the love of my kids, the love of my wife. So that's what this next song is about. It's about just saying thanks. Just being grateful for what God has done.
All my words fall short. everyone. I just really feel on my heart this morning that we need to call Uncle Stephen and Auntie Linda to the front. I don't know, but this is really no small thing God has done for Carmen and Lester. And these two new lives born, Max and Leo. And I just want Uncle Stephen and Auntie Linda to come forward, please. I know that they've thanked God in their house. But I want them, Uncle Stephen, if you can come, and Auntie Linda, I just want you in front of the church just to pray and thank God. And just because I think this is just such an amazing miracle.
Pray. I just want to share the scripture that God gave to us yesterday morning. As we thank God for the miracle of our twins that he gave to my sons. Now that scripture, I want you to know, that's on the wall. That says, when we serve the Lord your God, and he will bless our bread and water, and he will take sickness away, and no one will suffer miscarriage or be barren in your land. Me and my husband, I've been praying that every week. My children is 20 years married, and on Friday morning, the 7th of July, God bless them with the two little twins, Max and Leo. And as we were praying, this is the scripture God gave me, and I don't know for who it is. And the heading of it said, the unforgetful God. And I want to say to any of you, God's promises is yay and amen. He's an unforgetful God. So I'm going to read from verse 12, because that's what God gave me. Now, I don't know this version. Leanne, I trust this version is God's version. And he says, neither, this is what the Lord says, in the time of my favor, I will answer you. And in the day of salvation, I will help you. And this talks about the restoration of Israel. To be a covenant for the people and to restore the land and to reassign its desolate inheritance. And it says in verse 12, and I will turn all my mountains into roads, and my highways will be raised up. And so they will come from afar, from the north and from the west and from the region of Aswan. Shout for joy, your heavens, rejoice, your earth. Burst into song, your mountains. For the Lord comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones. And Zion said, and the Lord has forsaken me, and the Lord has forgotten me. You know how we say that? And God says, can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? Though she may forget, I will not forget. Verse 16 is the scripture that just jumped into my spirit, and it said, see, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands, and your walls are forever before me. Your children will hasten back, and those who laid waste depart from you. Lift up your eyes and look around, and all your children gather and come to you. As surely as I live, declares the Lord, I will wear them all as ornaments that you will put on them as bride. And so I'm just sharing this even here for you, because I'm thankful. Because God is a God of promise, and he never forgets. And he's so true to his word. And we're just overwhelmed. We're a little late because my son came to show us all the pictures and all the things. So keep them in prayer for the journey of the twins, all the stuff around it. Stephen, you.
Thank you, church, for being by our side, for all the prayers and all the outreach that went out to them. And when I asked my son this morning what made him think of those names, he said they named after great kings, Maximilian, and I think it's Leopolis, I don't think it's Leonardo. Leonidas. Lindis is Leonidas. But I know there's only one great king that could have performed such a miracle, and that's our Lord Jesus Christ. One great king. And I pray now, Lord, as these two miracles grow up into this world, Let them light shine because of the light of the King Jesus, the mercies and grace of our King and Lord and Savior that brought them into this world. We pray for the mother and father, Lord, that they will say their household will serve the living God and their children will be brought up shining the light of Jesus before them. Thank you, Father, for the miracle that has been performed, Lord. Thank you for giving us the reminder that you are still our God. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Thank you so much. Uncle Stephen and Auntie Linda, just stay. Father God, I just thank you for Uncle Stephen and Auntie Linda, Lord God. And I just pray that you bestow on them, Father God, just your grace, Lord God, to also bring up these two children in your name, Father God. Thank you, Lord God, that you have put them there to be a blessing, Father God, and to pray over these children, Father God. And thank you, Father God, that you give them and that you honor them, Father God, with whatever they need, Father God, to be the grandparents of these two, Father God, and also to support Lester and Carmen. Father, I just pray a blessing over them, Lord God. I pray a blessing over Lester and Carmen, Father God, and a blessing over Max and Leah, Father God, as they go, Father God, into this world, Father God. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I'm doing the offering this morning, and I just want to, I have to do a very other important announcement, and that is my friend's birthday tomorrow. So please, Michelle, wish Michelle happy birthday tomorrow, and also Charles. It's also Charles' birthday tomorrow, but that's very, very important, very important announcement. Okay, so actually, When I heard the news that Max and Leo was born, you know, I said to my husband, what came up to me was, you know, if God in all his goodness allows this miracle, then it means that this world is still worth saving, you know, there's still hope in this world. And yesterday I watched a video of two guys being interviewed, Jim Caviezel and Tim Bollard. They are, it's a new movie that is coming out, The Sound of Freedom. And it's about this guy, Tim Bollard, and how God has called him to free children from the sex trade. And how he just explained how God had called him. And it really touched me that, you know, he spoke about the fact that his wife actually spoke him and helped him talk through this when he had to make the decision not to leave his job and to pursue this route of really unknown future in knowing what he was really on his heart to do is to save children. And it relates to this verse in Matthew 7, verse 13 to 15, I'm not sure if the guys at the back were able to, Matthew 7, verse 13 to 15, if you can maybe just bring that up. Because all of us, you know, we have a choice, a daily choice ahead of us. We can either choose the easy way, or we can choose the more difficult way. And so this says, yes. Oh, goodness, what? King James, you okay. Enter in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which to go in there at your guys. Okay, 14, and 15? Beware, okay, no, it's not that one, okay. Mine is a little bit different, but I'm not going to. But basically it says, enter by the narrow gate. Okay, the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. The way is hard that leads to life. Sometimes we have to make, not sometimes, we have to choose whether we want to take the easy route. And Tim Bollard was saying, you know, the easy route was staying in his job, having a pension, everything secure. The hard route was the route that he couldn't see the future. the future that was not secure for his family, the future that was difficult. But that was the future that led them to save like hundreds of children out of the sex trade. And in Galatians 6 verse 9, it said, "Let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up." And I think this is important for us to understand that God's way is never an easy way. It's not easy. We have to, each one of us, where we find ourselves, each day we have to choose, are we going to do the right thing, the more difficult thing, the thing that we know to do, what is right to do, or are we going to choose the easy way out? God is not necessarily you're not going to necessarily not end up in heaven if you choose the easy way. I'm not God, I don't know. But you will definitely not reap the reward. I was listening to somebody else saying, you know, that when God called Abram, this was Jordan Peterson that says this, when God called Abram, Abram was in a very relaxed place. He was very rich. He had everything that he had needed. But God called him out of that complacency, out of that place where it was his comfort zone. And God called him on an adventure. He called him to his purpose. And for each one of us, and relating this to the offering message today, is that we are called on an adventure, God's adventure. We are called to do the right thing. We are called to, wherever we are, make the right choices. Because if we don't do it, then there isn't a future for Max and Leo. We are the ones that are making the decisions, that are pushing back the darkness for these little ones to still have a future and a hope within this world. So that's my message this morning to you, is make that choice, to make the difficult choices and to do what is right. Because like this Tim Ballard, he really gave everything up, but he never would have realized how God has blessed him. He's testifying now. He had six children when he left his job. But God has just provided and provided. And I haven't watched this movie, but I think it's really amazing to see what God can do when people are fully devoted and given over to him. So I'm going to ask my sons to just take up the offering for us. But let us just pray. Father, thank you, God, that you are God, Lord. And God, we can give nothing more to you than you have already done to us, Lord God. And we just thank you this morning, and we pray that you will convict each one of us in our hearts, Lord God. What is that thing that we have to do or give up, Father God, to be in obedience to you, Father God, and to make a difference in this world? We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
I just wanted to introduce the speaker. It's a very rare occasion where I get to shout Jaco's accolades. But I went onto the internet and I typed in Jaco Bekker, and it said, Jaco Bekker is a South African rugby union player. I think that can't be Jaco. But Jaco, whatever you do this morning, don't be too charming, right? Just be yourself.
Listen, he hopes he's not going to be targeted today, but I can't make any promises. Morning, everybody. The children can go to Kiddies Church if they've got Kiddies Church, or they can remain. I'm actually going to start with my message. Talita actually jumped ahead of me. And some of you might have heard the scripture. Oh, it's not the scripture, definitely not the scripture, but it says, the wife is the neck, directing the head. The husband is the head, but the wife is the neck. That is so unbiblical. That's a Jezebel spirit. But, and the reason I can substantiate that, we are the bride of Christ. Are we directing where Christ, what Christ must do? No. So, okay. So that's my scriptural. But what the wife is, Proverbs 12, verse 4, an excellent wife is the crown of her husband. That is what she is. And my crown is her birthday is tomorrow. So, yeah. That is indeed with Charles. Well, it's not my crown, but all the best for Charles also tomorrow, but my crown's birthday is tomorrow. Now, people, today, as you've heard, I have the privilege to share a word with you, and I'm humbled, but I'm not jumping with joy, and I never jump with joy when Pastor William asks me. The reason being is I am not the smartest pencil in the pencil case, number one, and number two of James 1 saying, listen, teachers, not everybody, don't be excited to be a teacher because you will judge more harshly. So, and I told Pastor William, you know, for me it is, I know always, it feels like God is telling me, Jaco, you write the script so that you can't afterwards complain and say you didn't know. And I always thought for this impression, me standing one day in heaven before God and saying, God, but I didn't know, man. Lord, and did you know? I didn't know. So I know this won't be the case. And actually, neither will you be able to say, even if you say, listen, God, in all honesty, it was Jaco sharing the word. The first 10 minutes, he offended the first third of the church. After 20 minutes, another third was so confused, we couldn't find our behinds, even with both hands in our back pockets. And the third third, the last third, they couldn't even concentrate because of his bad grammar and use of the English language. So you really should have actually seen somebody better to share this word. But be it as it may, I think you might get a pass, but I won't get a pass. So, but what is clear is that we definitely need less of me. And so let's pray and just pray that God will speak through me, open your hearts, remove the offense. Yeah. Lord, thank you that we can gather here as a family in you. I pray that as we've sang, that your spirit will just bind every hindrance in our minds, every fear, every anxiety, and just open our hearts, open our minds, that we will receive from you, Lord. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you will speak through me. I pray that you'll use my gestures, my language, my faults, and everything. And I pray that people will see past it and that we will hear you. Amen. Some of you might know that I really love the prophets in the Old Testament. So a few weeks ago when Renee ministered out of the prophets, I was so excited. I thought I found a kindred spirit in it. And what I love about the Old Testament, the prophets there, is that's actually, they just believed who God said he was. And when he asked him something, they did it. And this is for me where the wheels for me come off, actually, when I look at that. Because not do I only have this amazing ability to distract myself with my ADD mid-conversation, I entertain myself with my own hypocrisy. And to give you an example, for those, hopefully you are better parents than I am, it's not difficult, but so for me it is when I talk to my boys, two amazing angels, if they want to be. But what frustrates me is that many times it feels I must ask them a multitude of times to do something. Or I ask them, they say they will do it, and it just never happens. And then I get so angry at them. And then I think, yes, Jaco, but isn't that exactly how you act when God asks you something? When he asks you something, then you have 110 questions, and then you want, God, did you really mean this, or did you mean that, or let me get a confirmation. You want me to go. Okay, but where do you want me to go? Is there a pin drop? When do you want me to go? All these questions. And when my children ask me all these questions, when I ask them to do something, I get frustrated. And that's why I say, for me, it is my own hypocrisy. I expect my children to do what I'm not actually doing when God asked me to do. And what was interesting is I can't remember if I saw a video or read it, but where this educator said, listen, when you talk to your children, sorry, those lights. When you have children and they're busy with something, you talk to them, you must first get their attention. So let's say with my children, they will be on the device, on the TV, then I mustn't just give them an instruction, because they're not concentrating, they're not listening. I must actually get them to stop what they're doing and look at me and then give the instruction. And then I thought, okay, no, that is great. But it also made me think, how many times in our lives God has been prompting us to do something, we don't do it, and then chaos strikes, and then suddenly we focus on God. Then it is okay, we put down what we're busy with, and then we focus. So for me, it was actually, as I said, interesting to see how many times what happens to us, even in our adult life, how much it's not, how similar it is to actual parenting. Not that I'm some expert on that anyway. So what I've realized is obedience is something that we all demand, but we're slow to give or do. And the scripture that hits me hard actually is in 1 Samuel 5:22. If you can put that on. But not the New King James. Put the New King James. You have New King James. If the King James, I can't read that high English. I have limited English words. But to give you the background, Saul was king at that stage. They went out to a war, and what God gave them certain commands regarding this war. So first of all, they had to be the priests had to come and sacrifice and pray for everybody, intercede, and when they demolish the people, they mustn't take anything. But what happened was, Samuel was slow, apparently, according to Saul. So what Saul did was, he did the offering and praying. And then they went into war, and they also then plundered and took the stuff. And as they finished the war, Samuel arrived. And in 1 Samuel 15:22, what we read is the New King James, what Samuel tells Saul, "Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to eat than the fat of rams." Here Samuel directly states that, listen, obedience is way more important than any sacrifice, anything that we can do, irrespective of our intentions. And just as a side note, another ADD kicking in, is when Saul answered Samuel here, in verse 24, he says, "Then Saul said to Samuel, 'I have sinned.'" Oh, yeah, no, that's right. "For I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord." Yeah, that's right. "And your words." But here's the reason he gives. "Because I feared the people and obeyed their voice." So this is not the, and for me, it was just actually this his reasoning. He feared the people and obeyed their voice. Something similar that we obviously read, from Pilatus, Pilate, when he judged Jesus. So what's interesting is that we pray to hear God's voice and ask God to use us. But when we get to the place where we feel we must share a word with the congregation or a person, we don't do so because we fear what people might say or think. And that is us actually so heartbreaking is that the fact that we sit here or in your soul, or wherever you are, and you say, oh, God, speak to me, do this, do that. But we're so reluctant to then, when he does so, to act upon it. So when it comes to obeying the word of God, we look at it, my opinion is that we look at it grudgingly, as if it is a chore, as if it will benefit God more than us, as if it's now an inconvenient time to do so. We have excuses as to why we cannot do it now. We want 110 confirmations before we act on His word. And as I said, for some reason, we get angry when our children, or let's say, even if you're in a position of, well, we're all in a position of authority where we work, but when other people do the same with us. In Deuteronomy 5:33. Thank you. I've got a co-host. You can put that one up. There he says, it's a simple, a short scripture where it says, you shall walk in all the ways which the Lord your God has commanded you, and you may live, and that it may be well with you, and that you may prolong your days in the land which you shall possess. This is not the only scripture that talks about God's promises. And somebody earlier said God's promises, and yes and amen, but we will touch on that. And that same big word, my co-host, please, Deuteronomy, Isaiah 28, is a big chapter that deals with blessings and cursings. The first 14 chapters talks where God spells out all the blessings that you will have if you obey. 14 verses. But verse 15 to 68, that is 53 verses, he spells out of all the cursing that will come over you if you do not obey. And what is, I want to make it clear, it is not as if he's, God is not saying, I will curse you because you don't obey me. God is not petty like that. He's just telling you, listen, if you're not following me, you're outside, let's say, my light. You will get hurt there. You will get damaged there. It's not because I want it for you. I want you to be here. I'm not actively going to do it, but that is what's going to happen. And as I said, these two scriptures are not the only ones that deals with all the blessings that God has in store for us. There are many, many scriptures that confirms this. But not only were the Israelites confronted with, let's say, these scriptures, we are as well today. And what was interesting is, on a continuous basis, both the Israelites and ourselves, we find ourselves at the T junction called 2 Chronicles 7:14. The well-known one, which we all quote when there's a prayer meeting, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. And for me, it is just so amazing, is that we know these promises. We know these promises. How do we end up at a spot where we have to, as I said, 2 Chronicles 7:14? How come we don't just actually stay obedient and walk in those promises? It is for me, it was, obviously I don't have an answer. I'm looking at myself. I'm not talking at you today, or as I said, it was a list that I had to make for myself here. Yeah. Now, as I said, for me it's a lack of obedience. It's a lack of obedience. That is why the Israelites and we ourselves find ourselves at that scripture continuously. Because we only get to enjoy the blessings when we follow God's instructions. I've already started offending people earlier before church, so I have to take a break now. Give me 5 minutes, 2 pages, and then we're there again. Okay, so many of us want to God to speak to us specifically in a way. Is, let's say, my child, this is God. I want you to quit your job. You will get a paycheck every week, and you will be a millionaire, and all your needs will be met. That is how we want. We almost want like a detailed thing. But how God actually speaks is, I want you to quit your job. And is that God? So that was just an example. It wasn't a word for anybody, Lawton. As I said, that was a spare example. But I'll give you examples in a way that some of you spoke touched on earlier, how God spoke to people. So let's say Genesis 12:1, the one that we mentioned earlier at Alita, the Lord said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. Bread. Now, for me, it is, I would have asked for a pin drop. So where do you want me to go now? You want me to leave here, but I want a pin drop. My wife would have asked, okay, God, but what's the temperature there? What's the weather like? I need to pack accordingly. And so for me, this again, I'm just thinking, Abram, that is a word Abram received, and he moved. Genesis 22, verse 2. Then God said, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac. So he's really getting specific there. And go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain. I will show you. Again, for me, there would be a whole lot of questions. There needs to be confirmations. I'm going to call in the Crowleys. Listen, we need to we need to get praying about this. And for me, it is amazing how that is what Abram did. And what is also for me interesting is, and I thought, the difference between Abram and me. And because if I just clearly on these two scriptures, let's say this was spoken to me. I don't think it would have happened, in all honesty. I don't think I would have moved, number one, if I only look at these two scriptures. And if God tells me, listen, pick a boy, even if he tells me to pick a boy, take the most naughtiest one, it would be difficult. But what I realized, the difference between Abram, why Abram could do that, was due to the relationship he had with God. There was a continuous relationship with God. He knew that that child, that Isaac, that child that was a blessing from God, that was a child God provided. God created a miracle for that to happen. It wasn't just ta-da, everything that happened with Abram, there was a miracle connected. He had that relationship. And for me, I was thinking about, if I had that relationship with God, I would have done it. So the difference between Abram and myself is the relationship. And you know what was interesting is even when, yes, Abram had everything. I'm not going to dispute that. When God called Abram to leave his father's house, as Talita shared earlier. But remember, even Abram's dad was called by God. So God wasn't foreign to Abram. Do you understand? So there was still a relationship there. But as I said, it comes down to the relationship. And when we come to a point where we start to, I will get to that now. Just back. So here, those were two examples where God gets, let's say, a one-liner, I almost want to say. There's a where God gave a little bit more detail was, for example, in 1 Kings 17, verse 2 to 16. That is where Elijah I think he just actually with the Baal prophets, the whole scenario, but he prayed and there wasn't rain. God told him, listen, go to the brook. I've commanded the ravens to feed you or bring you food. So God told him, listen, it's a bit more specific. Go there, this is what's going to happen. Then when the brook dried up, God again told him, listen, go to that town. I've commanded a widow to look after you. So there was a little bit more detail. So I can say, okay, God, okay, I can work with this. I can work with this. Then we get examples of there where there was more, let's say, more step-by-step, more detailed instructions. The one is in Matthew 21, verse 1 to 7. That is where Jesus told his disciples, listen, go to this town. There you will find a donkey. I think it's a colt. Take that donkey, bring it to me, and if people ask you about it, then tell them this. And this is what happened. So there was a more step-by-step scenario. Another one is in Acts 9, verse 10 to 19. That is where... Ananias, where God told Ananias, listen, go to this place, go to that house, there's Paul, do this, this, and this. So it's again step by step, and God also gave this, let's say the reverse instructions to, I think for Saul, Paul. But anyway, I'm trying to make is, so here was the various scenarios where God gave from one-liners to a bit more specific. But even in the last set of examples that I've shared with you, it was for a specific scenario or specific case. God never told anybody step by step every day. He didn't take Michelle's calendar and says, listen, okay, you will in the morning get up at 5 o'clock, 5 to 6 you will do this, 6 to 7 you will do this, then you will do this, then Johnny will come over, you will do this. No, God will never give you a complete set, step-by-step, everything up front. And the reason being is, he doesn't want to control you. He wants to give you the free will to follow him and to experience it with him. So when God gives a word, it will, in many times, as I mentioned here, will be, I don't want to use the word vague, Auntie Linda, what is the right word? But it will be like a general word. There might be a hint of specifics, but it won't be a step-by-step complete, yeah. So what is clear from these examples is even though everything does not make sense, we need to obey. Now, for me, I was never in the army. I think my mom was very happy that I didn't have to go. I think parents would have been happy. I think it would have done me great. But we will never know. But the impression that I got from the army is that, or at least from the movies, obviously that is that, and I think Rudy's the only one in the church that still posts army pictures, but I haven't spoken to him about that. He's not here today, but the impression I get is that you've got this person in charge. I know they've got titles, but I've got like sergeant or major, but I don't know where it fits in. I don't want to offend our army as well. Is you've got the person in charge who gives commands to the troops, and they do it. Whether they like the person or not, they do it. And for me, it's almost like they say they know there would be negative consequences for not obeying that command. So, as I said, irrespective if whether they trust or respect the person, they still do it. I almost want to say the fear of man is there. But even if you take the troops, let's say you've got a commander or a group that works together. Now they go on a mission. On the mission, they will give each other commands. Let's say, I'm not even going to try. But let's say crouch, command, proceed, go two of you go that way. They're not having an argument while they're doing this, or discussion, or, Linda, who really put you in charge here? Yeah, do you really know what you, no, that if Linda says go there, Jaco go there, Jaco goes there. Leanne go there, Leanne goes there. Michelle, look out, Michelle. So what I've seen, so when in that scenario, what I realize, if you look at it, is that they obey each other because there's a trust. And they understand that the individual success, but also the team success, depends on obeying the commandments. Now, the alternative to, the impression is therefore created that we either, one of the reasons we do not obey is that we either do not trust God and believe that He has the best intentions for us, and we actually only really do lip service to scriptures like Jeremiah 29:11. The alternative to say, listen, even if you tell me, listen, Jaco, no, but I do trust God. Let's say the alternative then is that you don't obey God because you're selfish. And it's either, you're selfish either because it's not convenient for you, or you're concerned about what people might think. Neither of these two possibilities are great. So I therefore urge you to search your heart as to the reason why you are not obedient to God in certain areas of your life, which you know, other area of your life, or doing why you're not doing what you feel in your heart you have to do, what God has been calling you to do. We tend to think that, listen, being obedient to God only affects you, but it doesn't. It affects the people around you. To give you an example, I'll give you a few. Remember I spoke about Elijah going to the brook, and then God told him, listen, go to the widow. I directed her to feed you. When Elijah came to that widow, we read, listen, she took her last bit of flour and oil to bake a bread for her and her son, and I think the dramatic words is, are we going to eat it, then we're going to die. Like, I don't say it's not true, I'm just saying it is very dramatic. So if Elijah wasn't obedient to God and went to there, because you hopefully know what happened. Okay, let me just tell the story because I see I'm losing Martinez. He didn't read that part. So Martinez, what happened was, Elijah went to the widow. The widow told him that. He says, but don't worry. Make the food and you will be sorted. So she made him food. And we read that she didn't run out of oil and flour, and she and her son ate, I almost want to say, forever. So if Elijah, if he wasn't obedient, she would have died. She and her son would have died. It's only because he was obedient they could have been, God could intervene into that lady's life, and she and her son could die. She and her son could live. 2 Samuel 11, it's a bit different. That is where David, again, Israel was at war. But David decided he's not going with his army like a king should. So he was disobedient, number one. Then he decided one evening, because now he's bored. All his buddies are out at war. He's got nothing to do. So he went to the movies on the roof. He saw a lady. And then he said, listen, I think I need some geselskap. And then one thing led to another. And it ended up by him killing her husband. So here again, he destroyed families by his disobedience. Another example is when we read in Mark 3:27, it says, No one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man, and then he will plunder his house. Now you may ask me, Jaco, how the heck are you stretching it? I say, listen, with an ADD mind, anything is possible. Here we read, what binds you? Sin binds you. A strong man, I'm telling you, if I'm going to try to bind Martinus now, hy gaan my so vinnig plat trek, dit gaan nie snaaks wees nie. Nobody else is going to do it. But what will be able to bind Martinus? I'm just using his example. It's not the word from God that you're dealing with. Sorting. But Rudy is not here. So unfortunately, but only sin, so if sin binds the strong man, so the bond, that is then how, so if Martinus, is this if there's sin in your life, you will be bound, and then that what the scripture says, you will be robbed, your house will be robbed. But then the alternative, remember the opposite is also so, as long as he walks in the light, he won't be bound and you won't be robbed. So your actions affect those around you. Now these points, everything I mentioned, I want to bring it all together in one story that we find in the Bible. Or it's not a story, it's an event. And it's reported in all four of the Gospels, but the one that I will focus on is the one in Luke, specifically Luke 5, verse 2 to 11. I've got the New King James Version, because, as I said, but it seems a computer only has the King James. So, but I'm going to read from the New King James from my papers again. If you've got a Bible, please follow along, because it might make a bit more sense for you. Verse 2. So it was, as the multitude presented about, this is a famous story about, for those who don't have Bibles here, and just going to knock off in 5 seconds, this is where Jesus went on the boat in the water, ministered to people. So it was, as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. That was not Jesus. And he saw two boats standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the land. Now what it means is, just ask him, listen, put the boat a little bit more in the water. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats, so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, Do not be afraid. From now on you will catch men. So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him. Now, this event can, I almost want to, as I said, end off now with, let's say, break it down in 3 points for you to take home. Obeying God in small matters is an essential step in receiving God's greatest blessing. Imagine Peter, so let's take it to the first step. So Jesus went there and got in a boat. Said, Simon, take me out a little bit. Imagine Peter said, listen, I'm tired. I just worked all night. I'm busy finishing or cleaning my nets because we have to go out again tonight. No. Or he says, listen, can't you jump in the other guy's boat? There's another boat. Go in the other one, man. Or he said, Listen, I already went out fishing. I'm done. If Peter said anything other than yes, he would have missed the blessing. He would have missed the greatest fishing experience in his life. But because of his obedience, the Lord arranged a miracle that he would never forget. So often God's greatest blessings come as a result of our willingness to do something that appears very insignificant. Push out the boat. Say to Auntie Linda you love her. God loves her. Go tell somebody God loves him. Oh, I pray for you. How can I help? Ask yourself, has God been challenging you to do something seemingly unimportant that you have not yet made an effort to accomplish? Is there anything you have rationalized by saying it is too difficult, I don't want to, or I have to pray about it first? So that's the first one. Second heading. As I said earlier, our obedience always benefits others. In this event, who were the people who benefited from Peter's obedience? First, the crowd, because now they could see and hear Jesus better. Second, Jesus benefited because we read he could now sit and minister to them. Third is Peter himself, because obviously the economical benefit that he received, the fish. And the fourth is the people around him, his business partners, also benefited from that catch. And through all of this, they were able to testify of God's goodness. See, because even if, and this is what I want to remind you again, and this is what I tell people, so I need to go back to that scripture. There were two questions that Jesus asked Peter, two. The one is, listen, push the boat out a little bit further. And the second one was, listen, go deeper and throw out your net. Jesus was a carpenter by trade. Peter was a fisherman. Now, Leanne is a doctor. You are a doctor, eh? Okay, I'm not a doctor. But it's like me coming to Leanne, who's standing next to the operation table, and me telling Leanne what to do. She's going to say, listen, Jaco. Oulike ouwtjie raak, jou ma's lief vir jou, maar jy moet jou maar stil bly. And this is, in a sense, what Peter could have said. Jesus, you're a carpenter. I think I've been in this spot the whole night. We caught nothing. Now is not the best time for fishing. If it was the best time for fishing, we would have went out fishing now, not last night. Of course, we'll tell you about when to catch fish and all that stuff. But listen to Peter's words. So Peter tell him all the, he says, Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. So tell God your excuse, but don't stop there. Look what he says next. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. And for me, that was amazing. If Peter stopped, but God, okay, you talk nicely, but I tried last night, I'm tired now, can we do it later? Now is not the best convenient time, my girlfriend is over, I don't really want, anything, if you stop there, If Peter stopped there, he would not have received the... You know, people would still have been blessed up to that stage, but what I mean, it's not a once-off. Your walk with God is continuous. The continuous obedience, continuous blessings in that. So, but for me, the words never... This is like, you know, what is this guy, Joseph? It was Joseph who I almost want to say Potiphar's wife. Who's that guy? Is it Potiphar's wife? Yes, yeah. But she pursued him every day. And obviously it was a beautiful woman. And he told her, how can I do such a wicked thing towards my God? That is one of the most beautiful phrases to me. But the other one that is so is, nevertheless, at your word I will. The third point is, when we obey God, we will never be disappointed. Oh, sorry, I missed. Okay, so that's okay. It actually fits in here. Peter no doubt assumed that Jesus' fishing instructions would amount to a waste of time. But when he complied with Jesus' request, Jesus brought about a miracle that gripped the disciple with amazement. Jesus turned an empty boat into a full one. So the next time you quote God's promises, remember, we cannot rely on God's promises without obeying his commands. That's it today, people. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that we have the privilege to share your word. We have the privilege to be in relationship with you. We have the privilege to worship you, to praise you, to share your name with those around us. Lord, we have so many excuses as to why we are not obedient to your word. We are quick to quote your promises. We are quick to quote all the blessings that we want and what, however we name it or claim it or whatever we want to do it. But Lord, we are so slow to seek a relationship with you, number one, to be obedient to your word. I pray that during this week, that you will just remind us of the words that you've spoken over our lives, the words that you've spoken, the directions that you've given us, Lord. And I pray that we will be obedient, that despite our excuses that we might raise, that we will, just like Peter said, but Lord, nevertheless, Lord, I'm afraid of what people might think of me. I'm afraid of what people might say. I'm afraid how it will be perceived. I'm afraid people might think I'm weird. I'm afraid where will my paycheck come from. I'm afraid what I will do when I move. Lord, but I pray that our love for you, our trust in you, will be greater than the fear of man, will be greater than our selfishness, Lord. Lord, I pray that we will have a hunger for your word. I pray that we will take these opportunities of being able to draw near to you, that we will take those opportunities with both hands and not just think, oh, tomorrow is another day, or, oh, I've been too busy. I pray that we will have a healthy fear of who you are, Lord, that we will realize that you are the creator, that you, without you, we cannot breathe. Without you, we cannot live. Without you, we have nothing, Lord. And I pray that you will help us, that we will draw near, and not just for our own sake, but for the sake of our families. And Lord, I pray that you will help us, that we will that we will have a love for those that you sent over our path, Lord, that we will share your goodness, that we will share your love with them, Lord. Amen.
You may stand. I want to thank Jaco for his word and obedience. Yeah, it's always interesting to me that that Abraham was obedient, but what we look at that as is we look at it as faith. Like, if faith is the internal act, the internal conviction, then obedience is the external action. But you can't separate the two. And because of that, we have what we have. Because of that, generations were blessed. Because of that, we are blessed. Because Abraham was obedient. And it's always difficult to be obedient because you have to put your wants and your needs, what you want, last. And sometimes you even need to forget about what you want altogether, because it's not about what you want. It's about being obedient. Which I think why it's so difficult. Right. So we're going to end off with the song Fall Away. After that, the church will be, the service will be over. If any of you need prayer, there's my wife, my lovely wife in the corner, Talita. There's Michelle, there's Jaco, there's me. You're more than welcome to come to the front and we will pray with you. Trust God with you. All right.
Thank you.
reën daar buite, Here Vader, vir die seëninge in ons lewens, Here. Here, vir die feit dat U God is, Here, en dat U gister en vandag en môre dieselfde is. Baie dankie vir U onvoorwaardelike liefde vir elkeen van ons hier. Here, seën elkeen hier vanoggend, seën elkeen wat by die huis is en ons luister vanoggend, Here Vader, seën almal onder my voice vanoggend, Here Vader. Here, seën Bethany, gaan hierdie week vooruit en berei vir elkeen 'n plekkie voor, Here Vader. Here, baie dankie. Here, ons het so baie om vir dankbaar te wees vanoggend. As ek bid in vrou Jesus naam. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Enjoy the week. Go with God and He will go with you.
Hi, thank you so much for watching Bethany's YouTube channel. If you enjoyed today's video, kindly leave a like or comment below. And while you're there, hit the subscribe button to ensure that you don't miss out on upcoming videos. Feel free also to join us every Sunday, either at the venue or like you're doing right now, live stream at 9:30 a.m. every Sunday. And once again, thank you so much for watching this video, and please share with your friends. We love you and be blessed.